Today on the Roundhouse, we are talking to two members of the Tri-State Railway Historical Society, under 25, who just bought an Alco. All aboard!
In days past, the Roundhouse was where the railroad worker united with the steam locomotive, each to prepare for the journey ahead. Today, it's where we examine the history, the industry, the machines, the hobby, and the passion behind railroading. News, interviews, stories, and more. So climb aboard. This is The Roundhouse.
Welcome to The Roundhouse. I'm your host, Nick Ozarak, and this is episode number 57. Of our Trains and Railroading podcast, where we're talking about everything in the industry and the hobby, you name it, and we discuss it. Now, you may have heard recently that there's a group of young adults out in New Jersey who have managed to purchase an Alco C-424 locomotive. And you would have heard correctly. They join us here today on the Roundhouse, Vice President Mr. Kevin Fallon and Treasurer Richie King.
How you doing, Nick?
Good to have you guys on. Welcome to the show, Kevin, and good to have you back, Richie. Last time we were talking about your career as an author of the Rahway Valley Railroad books. Now we are talking about the one-to-one scale trains. So, Kevin, why don't you talk about how you first became connected with this locomotive?
For me, it's a family connection. So my brother's worked for the railroad for over 5 years. I think on two separate occasions, the railroad was my summer job. Not to mention the whole rest of my family works for a railroad to some degree. So I'm always around. I always know what's going on. So one day I get a text from my brother and he says, hey, 19 is for sale or 19's out of service. Is there anything we can do about it? So that really set forth the whole purchasing process here.
When you got that message, why had it been put up for sale?
So we actually got lucky in the way it went out of service. The railroad bought EMD locomotives and they're going to switch to an all in EMD fleet. So they just wanted to phase out the Alco. So, basically they decided next major failure, we're going to put the engines out of service. We lucked out because the engine went down for a flat spot on the wheel. Not a huge problem, but because they can't turn the wheel again, they don't want to invest the money into fixing the wheel. So they just sidelined the thing. And that was back in November.
So Richie, when Kevin approaches you and says, hey, this locomotive's up for sale, you being the money man, how do you start making this work as a purchase?
As a group, Tri-State has a great ability to raise funds and call on people to donate for these types of projects. So when Kevin approached me, I was like, we don't exactly have the money on hand to do this right now, but I'm sure we could gather enough interest and talk to the people that we know to get the money in line for this. So one of the organizations we have a tight relationship with is Liberty Historic Railway. And they have funded several big preservation projects in New Jersey. They funded the restoration of a Mars Canal boat. They've done several things to the URHS here in Booton, New Jersey. So we proposed the idea to them, and their board passed the resolution to underwrite the entire cost of the purchase. And it was really as simple as that.
Simple. And in many ways, you lucked out. From here, what is the plan as far as repairing the wheel and being able to put the locomotive back into operation?
Right now, again, like you said, we lucked out. We covered the whole purchase price for the engine, which is great. Right now, we have a $5,000 job to do on top of that, which is why we're raising funds. So, which is why we have our GoFundMe campaign going on right now, which is on our website, tristaterail.org. But what that's going to do is that's going to ensure that the locomotive comes to us running in service. The engine as it sits right now runs, and as far as we know, runs well. Obviously, it's more than 50 years old. It's worn out, but it's an operational locomotive. And it's we lucked out with a really rare opportunity to pull an engine out of service that runs as it sits. Right now, it can't leave the railroad because of the flat spot. It's too big for FRA to allow to run on any railroad. But as soon as we fix out the wheel set, the thing is good to go. It's a great fundraiser in that people donating are basically going to have instant gratification because the minute that wheel set comes back from the wheel shop, the engine's going to run.
The low starting price, too, is really great because a lot of these locomotive restorations, we're looking at the very baseline, maybe $50,000. but it usually is 100,000 and up because it's a lot more extensive work that's required. The fact that you're looking at $5,000 and that guarantees that the thing can move is really exceptionally great, because as you say, that makes your turnaround pretty quick. And you're already, as of recording this interview, at 30% of the way towards your goal too, which is incredible.
Right. And we're lucky we have some other donors who've donated individually to help cover the cost. But we're in a good spot is that we can't raise too much money for this, because there's two things that we can do with the money that's in the fund for this locomotive. A, we can fix it. Actually, I should say three things. We're going to fix it initially, and then we're going to maintain it for as long as we keep it, so we can keep it running. And as long as we have the money, we can send it places. And because Bootin is not an operating railroad, it's just a storage and restoration facility, we want to see the engine leave as often as possible. We have a few things in mind. Of course, we just bought the locomotive, so we can't guarantee anything. But the goal here is to see this thing run as often as possible and kind of be Tri-State's ambassador around New Jersey and around the area, and so people can get out and see the thing run.
Richie, as you know, often when a locomotive is preserved, there's always the big question of what paint scheme is it going to be preserved under? And this locomotive in particular has quite a history before it came to the M&E, but it also has quite an identity as a Morristown and Erie locomotive. How do you envision balancing out its history and showcasing that?
The engine is over 50 years old, and it's only ever worked for two railroads, and it's only ever worn three paint schemes, two of which were on the Toledo, Peoria, and Western Railway, and one of which was on the Morristown Erie. It makes the most sense for right now to leave the locomotive as is. The paint job on the engine is over 30 years old. It was painted, almost 30 years old. It was painted in 1988. And the paint's in great shape, so it doesn't really make sense for us to repaint it immediately into anything. And it's the Morristown Erie engine as far as New Jersey is concerned. It's worked here the past 30-some years, so we'd like to keep it in M&E for as long as possible until something else presents itself.
Part of what really impressed me with the launch of your campaign was the video where you had the voice of the New York subway system talk about the history of the locomotive and the campaign, with some really nice shots in there of the locomotive in operation on the M&E. How did that come together, and how has that been helpful for you?
So that was a project of mine. My background is in television. I currently am an intern for CBS News, and video production is just what I've done since I was in high school. So I'll be the first to tell you, one of the best ways to get people's attention is through video. And we also have Bernie Wagonblast, who, as you know, is one of the voices on the New York City subway. He's on the radio. He's on. He's the voice of the PATH train, PATCO, AirTrain at the airport. He's also a big train buff and a transportation professional. He was the first person we thought of when we said we would love to have a public figure who can endorse this for us. So he signed right up. And the next day we were shooting the video, and 2 days later we announced the fundraiser.
It's amazing how quickly these things come together. And obviously, being able to capitalize on the initial excitement of this is tremendous for seeing you over this initial hump of getting the wheels fixed. Richie, what cars does Tri-State own as far as making this a touring ambassador and having this serve to further Tri-State's other preservation goals?
The main problem I see right now is there is a disconnect between the people that started this rail preservation movement back in like the 50s and 60s and 70s and the kids that are our age and younger, in that the stuff that was preserved back then, the kids our age don't remember seeing it in operation. But as far as M&E 19 is concerned, kids my age, rail fans, they've seen the thing run as recently as last November. And there's an M&E rail fan page, and they post, okay, M&E 18 or M&E 19, work in the Chester branch, let's go out and take some pictures. So to have kids my age going out to be able to see this 50-plus-year-old ALCO working regular freight service, that's something that we can capitalize on to engage younger members into our organization, connect with them and tell them what we're about, and keep this rail preservation movement going. And I think M&E 19 is a great catalyst for that and lessening that gap between, the stuff that was preserved yesterday and the stuff that's being preserved today.
Generally speaking, New Jersey is not really a state that's conducive to what we're doing as far as railroad preservation, just geographically, economically. It's a small state with a lot of expensive land. So to have an engine that we can keep here but use places and have it run places and have it kind of travel to fill in the gap where we don't have a permanent train museum, I think it's an excellent opportunity for us. And right now, as far as Booten goes, between Tri-State and URHS, we have a lot of great restored equipment here. More than enough to start a museum with, but we can only get people here once a year. If we can get things to travel, we use this as our one running locomotive in the yard, we can expand our reach past just this location.
It seems, too, that Tri-State as an organization is very progressive. The fact that the two of you are on the board in the positions that you're in, having been elected to those positions, and then Rudy Garbley of Garbley Publishing, who we interviewed alongside you, Richie, last time, who's your president, the fact that you have an organization that has plenty of the 50, 60-year-old members with loads of experience, but who recognize the value in what you guys are bringing and are willing to provide you with the opportunity to seek out projects like this is absolutely fantastic.
Yes, I agree. It doesn't slide past me that these guys really trust us and what we're doing. They trust our judgment and our decision-making. They put us in positions where we'll be most beneficial to the group. In addition to being vice president, Kevin's also the chair of the equipment committee alongside our former president of over 20 years, Mike Delvecchio. So they're really in places where they can be of great use, and I'm treasurer. So a little bit of my background is I'm an accounting student and a management major at Ramapo College. So I'm really getting to use that knowledge that I built up while in college here for the group. And it's really worked very well. They trust us. They work with us. You know, it's a really great dynamic that we have here.
Well, Richie is a special example because, to pat him on the back a little bit, he is extremely qualified for the position he's in. But a job like president or vice president, there's no specific skill set for. So for the group to want us to be in that position, they have to buy into the vision that we have. This whole process, you know, particularly buying a locomotive, it was 8 weeks exactly from the day that Richie and I walked into the office at Morris Town & Erie to the day that we gave our deposit to buy the locomotive and made the announcement. So that's 8 weeks of hard work, but the only reason it was easy, and I use the word easy lightly, is because Tri-State, for at least the past 20 years, has a great reputation of being able to handle projects like this. And a lot of the people who are on our board now are the people who have been around for those 20, 30 years. So we were able to do this because of the reputation Tri-State has. We just needed to be the ones to go in and execute. So we owe our current board, A, for building up Tri-State's reputation, and B, for buying into what it is we want to do, allowing us to be in those positions and kind of letting us free to do it. And I think they'll agree, and we agree, that it worked out.
People who are joining us here and want to support the work you're doing, it sounds like the number one thing that anyone can do is go to your website and donate to help procure this wheel set. But beyond that, what are some of the other ways that people can help the work that you're doing?
What we do is very hands-on, and it's also a team effort. It gets a little dry when you're doing it alone, and the fun of it is doing it together. You know, we're always encouraging people who want to come here and work on the thing. We have a running locomotive now. I would love to have people be a part of that. Anybody who's wanted to work on running trains, you couldn't really find one at Booten, but now this is a unique opportunity to do that. And we have tons of other projects that are only held back by the amount of manpower we have. Any level of skills that you have are usable here. We encourage people to sign up with us. It's easy to at least express interest on our website through the volunteer page. Come try it out and see what it's like and meet the people who do it and realize that it's more than just free labor. It's a team effort. It's something that's fun. There's not really an activity that pays off at the end of the day as much as this does, when you can take something and transform it into something else completely different and completely new.
Being able to stand on the walkway as an Alco slowly burbles into life, that's a good feeling and a good reward indeed. Thank you both, Richie and Kevin, for joining us and sharing this work that you're doing. The website is tristaterail.org, and you can check them out and send donations their way to help get this thing back on the rails again. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Nick.
Thank you for having us.
If their campaign sounds interesting to you, you can check it out at tristaterails.org. And thank you guys for joining us here on The Roundhouse. You can check out all of our episodes at theroundhousepodcast.com. And remember that The Roundhouse is our house.